بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
إن الحمد لله. All praise and thanks is due to Allah عز وجل. نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره. We praise him, we thank him, and we beg his guidance and his forgiveness. ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. And we seek refuge with him from the evil of our own souls, our egos, and from the evil consequences of our actions. من يهده الله فلا مضل له. And whomever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides, there are none who can lead him astray. ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. And whomever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala leads astray, there is no one who can guide him. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. And I testify in front of all of you that there is no God who is truly worthy of worship except Allah alone and without partners. وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. And I further testify that Muhammad, the son of Abdullah, is his servant and his final messenger. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. O you who believe, fear your Lord and have consciousness of him. The fear and consciousness that he is deserving of you. And don't you dare die except as Muslims. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة. O humanity, fear your Lord who created you from a single soul, from our father Adam. وخلق منها زوجها. And from him he created his mate, our mother Eve. وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء. And from them both, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala populated the earth with many men and women. واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام. And fear your Lord through whom you ask your mutual rights. And never cut the ties of family, always uphold the ties of kinship. إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. Because indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ever watching over you and I. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا. O you who believe, O you who have attained faith, fear your Lord and speak a straightforward word. Always speak the truth. يصلح لكم أعمالكم. That he may repair your deeds. ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم. And perhaps that he may forgive you your sins. ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. And whoever obeys Allah and his messenger have achieved the greatest success that you could ever achieve in this life. إن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله. The best speech and the most truthful of speech, no doubt, is the book of Allah. وخير الهدي هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the best of guidance is that of our beloved prophet and teacher and leader and guide and best example, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَشَرُّ الْأُمُورِ مُحْدَثَاتُهَا. And the worst of affairs, brothers and sisters, are to attempt to try to introduce something new into this religion. وَكُلُّ مُحْدَثَةٍ بِدْعَةٍ. Every time someone tries to do that, it's a religious innovation. وَكُلُّ بِدْعَةٍ ضَلَالَةٍ. And every religious innovation, without exception, is nothing but misguidance. وَكُلُّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ. And every misguidance leads to nowhere except into the hellfire. As to what follows, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions in the Quran and speaks about a number of values. He speaks about a number of values in the Quran. And there are four in particular, brothers and sisters, that I want to share and discuss with you today. Now, these four values are mentioned throughout the Quran. And they are exemplified in the life and the legacy of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And these four values, brothers and sisters, these core values are faith, action, cooperation, and commitment. Faith, action, cooperation, and commitment. Now, brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions these four particular values collectively in one surah. Now, most of you, if not all of you, know this surah. It's Surah Al-Asr. It's the 103rd chapter of the Quran. And it only has three ayat. But these three ayat are so impactful and so significant that Imam al-Shafi'i, rahimahullah, Muhammad ibn Idris, a luminary in Islam, may Allah have mercy on him, he mentioned about this chapter, Surah Al-Asr, and these merely three verses. He said, لو ما أنزل الله حجة على خلقه هذه السورة لكفتهم إلا هذه السورة لكفتهم. That had Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not sent down any other evidence upon mankind except this one chapter, that would have been enough. Imam al-Shafi'i thought that these few verses and the values that are encapsulated therein were so important and so critical to the life of individuals, families, and community. He said that that would have been enough. If they want to know what it means to be successful in this life and the hereafter, it would have been enough. If they want to be saved on the day of judgment, it would have been enough. If they want to know what has to be priority for them in life, for any individual who wants to be successful, read this chapter and it would have been enough. Now, the chapter or this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, بَعْدَ أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ وَالْعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرِ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he starts off this verse by stating, brothers and sisters, or excuse me, swearing by time. Wal asr. And some things or points that are significant to note here is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is al-khaliq. Allah is the creator. Everything else in existence is makhluq. Everything else in existence is creation. Allah swears by whatever he wants from his creation. Allah can swear by whatever he wants. And he does so many times throughout the Quran. Wal-fajr, wal-layli, wal-shamsi, wal-duhaha. Allah swears by so many things. And he can do so because he is the creator and Lord of all that exists. However, for us, we are not allowed to swear by anything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because swearing by something is a way of honoring and venerating that thing. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he swears by something, he's not doing that haphazardly. He's doing that for reasons. To bring our attention to the importance and significance of something, the relevance of something, and that we need to pay attention to that thing. And in this verse, he swears by what? By time. And what is time, brothers and sisters? Time is opportunity. It is opportunity for us to learn and get to know who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, his most beautiful names, his most excellent attributes, his rights upon us, the commands that he has upon us, the prohibitions that we should stay away from. How can we strengthen our relationship with Allah to learn these things and get to know them? But not only that, brothers and sisters, it's opportunity. If we have strayed along the path and veered off, it is an opportunity for us to come back. When within time, when you're not dead, when your soul hasn't reached your throat, and it's not the day of judgment, and you have time, that's opportunity for you to return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever mistakes that you have made, whatever wrong that you have done, the skeletons that you may have in your closet, when you have time, there's opportunity. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by time to let us know that this is extremely important. Why? Because time is not endless, brothers and sisters. As we all know, time waits for no man or woman. Time is continually dragging us. It is continually taking us closer and closer to our ultimate end, which is the grave. And then beyond that, the hereafter. And then beyond that, the day of judgment. And then beyond that, either the hellfire or paradise. But when you're still alive, when you have time, that is opportunity, brothers and sisters, to come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you don't know who Allah is, time is opportunity for someone to embrace Islam, to learn the truth. But time is opportunity. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to say, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. Now, brothers and sisters, those four values that I mentioned, they are so critical and so important that they have to be at the core of any individual who claims to be a believer. Anybody who wants to have righteous children and a wholesome family, anybody who wants to have a thriving community, these four values, they must be present. They must be at the center. They must be at the forefront. If they are not, those people, be they individuals, families, or community, are ultimately doomed to failure and loss. And this is not my statement. This is the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inna al-insana lafi khusr. Every man, everybody is ultimately at a loss. They are losers, brothers and sisters. Everybody, except for who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes an exception for. And he does make an exception. He goes on to say, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِنُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. Except for those who believe. Except for those people who have faith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls everybody else losers, except for those people who faith is a core value to them. That is something that they value over everything else. It's priority for them. But to give us some perspective when we mean about what we mean or what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means about faith, to have the proper understanding, Imam Bukhari, rahimahullah, Muhammad ibn Ismail, he mentions in his monumental work, Al-Jami'u Sahih, commonly known as Sahih al-Bukhari. When he mentions about faith, he mentions Babun al-ilmu qabla al-qawli wal-amal. Knowledge preceding statements before you say anything and actions before you do anything. Knowledge has to precede statements and actions. And he brings an evidence for that in his book, brothers and sisters. And what does he say? He brings a verse of the Quran. فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لِذَنْبِكِ. Know, learn, be educated. Know that Allah subhanahu, there is no deity, there is no God worthy of worship except Allah. There is none else. But the important point here is what? No, have knowledge. You can't have knowledge unless you what? Unless you learn. And what is trying to be pointed out here, you can't have proper faith unless you learn. And in that verse, فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, know that Allah subhanahu, there is no God worthy of worship except Allah, وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لِذَنْبِكَ, then and only then are you supposed to seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What does that mean for us, brothers and sisters, practically? How am I supposed to learn about Allah first? Why do I have to do that first? And then seek refuge with Him and seek His forgiveness. If you don't understand that Allah is Al-Ghafoor and that He is Al-Ghafar, that is His name, day and night, that's what He does is forgive people, that He has mercy on them, that He is gentle with them, that He is looking to forgive people. If you don't know that, how can you properly make istighfar? You have to know who Allah is first. Only then can you come to Him properly. Only then can you know your role and His status and what your relationship truly is to Him. You have to learn that first. People, those of us who embraced Islam, you had to learn about Islam first. Those of us who were even born Muslim, you didn't come out knowing Islam. You had to be taught by your parents. فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. You had to know first. You had to learn first. Then وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لِذَنْبِكَ. Then you come to Allah. Then you'll know you come to Him on His terms. Then you won't ask questions like, why do I have to pray like this? Why do I have to exactly follow the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ? Why do I have to pray in this certain way or with these particular times? Because you know who Allah is and you know that's His right, that you come to Him on His terms. But that applies to entirely about our faith. And not only that, brothers and sisters, it is an obligation. It is a religious obligation that you learn the deen. كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم طلب العلم فريضة على كل مسلم. It is a religious obligation upon everyone to learn the deen. Now, for many of us in our community, oftentimes we are more concerned about our children, about them memorizing Quran. Everybody here wants their kids to be huffaz. All of us do. We want that crown of light on the day of judgment, that our children memorize the Quran. That we want them to go to Saturday and Sunday school, or we want them to go to a full-time Islamic school. But how many of us adults, how many mothers and fathers themselves are involved in circles of learning? This sacred knowledge, the book of Allah, the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. How many of us are involved in that? How many of us go to classes with a teacher who sit with other believers, brothers and sisters, in a community, learning the religion? Too often we're only concerned. Wallahi, you even see them come to the madrasa in the masjid, they just drop their kids off, they have nothing to do with reading the Quran, learning, studying, understanding, and then they just come back and pick up their children. Bas. But if you say, do they sit and learn? Allahul Musta'an. But if you want righteous, believing children, you want a wholesome family, you have to be doing that yourself first. You have to be involved in that first. You want your children to wake up at Fajr, and that to be easy, you have to be doing that yourself first. You want them to pray Qiyam al-Layl, you have to be doing that yourself. You want them to identify themselves and be proud of their Islam, you have to do that. And you can't do any of those things unless you learn the religion. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. And then you will have faith, proper faith. وَعَمِنُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. And righteous actions. Brothers and sisters, this is something that all of us have to have as a core value, that we commit ourselves to righteous actions. We have to not just be paying lip service to Islam, that when a coworker asks you because he saw something on the news and he says, hey, aren't you Muslim? And you just answer, yes, I'm Muslim. And that's the extent of whenever you identify with Islam. But when it's time to pray, when it's time to give sadaqah, when it's time to volunteer at the masjid, when it's time to help, when it's time to give charity, when it's time to make hajj, all of the different aspects of Islam, you're not there. You're not counted as present. But when they ask, a classmate in school asks you, are you Muslim? Then you say, I'm here, I'm present. But when it comes to the attendance of the actions, you're absent. You're not there. But when the people call, oh, yeah, of course I'm Muslim. How dare you even ask the question? I've been Muslim 13 years. I've been Muslim 10 years. Of course I'm Muslim. I was born Muslim. My grandfather's a mufti. Of course I'm Muslim. No. We have to have actions, brothers and sisters. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, if you don't have that as a core value, he said what? You are doomed to failure and loss. وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ. And this tawaso, this is cooperation, that we work together. None of us should ever think here, not any brother sitting right now in this musalla, not any sister sitting downstairs, none of us should think that you can do it alone. Don't think you can live this Islam, identify with Islam, and exemplify Islam, and exude Islam, and live Islam here by yourself. It's not possible, brothers and sisters. It is impossible. You want to know why? Because the best of creation, Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he didn't do it by himself. And if anybody could have done it, if anybody could have pulled it off, if anybody could have pulled through, it would have been him. But didn't he have Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu? Didn't he have Umar ibn Khattab? Didn't he have Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, Zayd ibn Thabit, Usama ibn Zayd, and the list goes on. How many of his companions did he have? How many disciples? How many people who were there with him, shoulder to shoulder, fighting battles, doing business, traveling, even marrying their children to each other, them even marrying brothers, sisters, all of these things, community, together, not by themselves as individuals. Not by themselves as individuals. Isa alayhi salam, he had his hawariyun. He had his disciples. Ibrahim alayhi salam, his sons were prophets and all in his progeny. Musa alayhi salam, he made dua that he had somebody to stand with him. His brother Harun. We cannot do it by ourselves, brothers and sisters. You have to be a part of the community. كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم يد الله مع الجماعة, that the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with the community. Those of you who think you're survivalists, you know those guys who go out away in the woods and live by themselves? That's not how it is in Islam. We're supposed to thrive, and the only way you can do that is with community. And it is all throughout Islam, practically. Even if you don't even know that much Quran, you can just observe Islam and see. This Jumu'ah, can I come and give the khutbah to nobody? Is that a Jumu'ah? Does it fulfill the rights of Jumu'ah? No, there must be community. If you want to pray Salatul Jama'ah, the very word itself, Jama'ah, is community, is congregation. You cannot do it alone. When you make Hajj, can you do it by yourself? No, there's 3 million, 4 million people from all over the Muslim world, but it's what? All together. Community. This is something that is extremely vital and important. And it's a value that we must have if we want to survive as Muslims, if you want to be successful both in this life and in the next. And it's the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا. Hold tightly, all of you together, as a community. Hold tightly to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Hablullah, or the rope of Allah, Ibn Abbas, he said that this is meant the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hold tightly to the sunnah, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, that is a value that we have to have, that we value knowledge, sacred knowledge, that we hold on together, that it's that what binds us together. The book of Allah, that's going back to that knowledge again. That's where we derive our faith from. How do we believe properly? What are the rights of Allah? The prohibitions? What's going to happen on the day of judgment? What is the reward for those who obey Allah? What are the reward of those who are righteous? What is the punishment for those who don't believe? What is the punishment of those who ignore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? All of that is derived from the Quran. But again, as what? As a community, we have to do that. So that third thing is what? Is cooperation. And fourthly, is commitment. Is commitment. Now, وَتَوَاصَوْ بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْ بِالصَّبْرِ. Is that patience. Patience, brothers and sisters, is something that we need. It's something that we have to have. It's something that is so crucial that, wallahi, brothers and sisters, you can't accomplish anything that is worth noting, that is worth mentioning, except that you have commitment to that thing. And what is commitment except that you're patient with it, that you stick it out, that when it gets tough or that when it gets difficult, you stick it through. Because you learning the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you trying to understand your place in this world and you trying to foster your relationship with Him and your commitment to Him and you're committing yourselves to actions and you're working with your brothers and sisters, that's not always easy. Sometimes it's going to be hard finding a sheikh that has time or speaks the language, or understands where you're coming from. That's not always easy to find that here. Or a masjid that's open and accessible. Or classes what you need. Or to find a brother, righteous brother or sister to get married to. Or to give charity, even though you don't have really that much money in your pocket. It's not always easy. But it takes commitment. To connect yourself with a community and working with other brothers and sisters who might see things differently from you. That takes commitment. That even though you have little differences of opinion, you might have a falling out, you might have an argument, but that you still forgive. That you swallow your pride and your ego and you put that down for the greater cause, for something bigger than yourself. That takes commitment. And these four values that I mentioned, brothers and sisters, excuse me, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, these are the values that we need to have, brothers and sisters, in order for us to thrive as a community. And I ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala show us the truth for what it is and that He bless us to have these values for us and our children, for our loved ones, and that He guide those who are family members are not Muslim, that He guide them to these values and the truth. And I exhort and encourage all of you to beg Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's forgiveness. And I do the same for myself. Innahu huwa al-ghafur rahim. Because indeed he is the most forgiving and the especially merciful. الحمد لله وحده وكفى وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ثم أما بعد. In the name of Allah, the most beneficent and the especially merciful, we ask Him to send His peace and blessings upon the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that should suffice any man. As to what follows, so as I mentioned before, sitting down, brothers and sisters, these core values that we need to have as individuals, if we want to live a meaningful life as Muslims, that there's any substance behind our words when we claim that we are believers. That if we want to have wholesome families, as I already mentioned, believing children, righteous daughters, and proactive, righteous sons, a wholesome family, a family of believers like Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam and his family. And if we want to have a thriving community like that of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba, the best example of a thriving community, both before and after, when they were in Mecca and in Medina. But when they were in Medina, that's when they really thrived and grew and flourished. If we want to have something like that, brothers and sisters, we have to have these four values: faith, action, cooperation amongst us in the community, and commitment. And so, brothers and sisters, it was in September that we started having khutbas here at this masjid. It was September 23rd. Just before that, alhamdulillah, there was discussion and a couple of us took it upon ourselves to try to put those values at the center and make them our moral compass at this masjid. Not for ourselves, but for the entire community. And anybody else, anyone else, who wants to exemplify, live, and share those same values. That is something that we're trying to do here now at this masjid. It is why I give the khutbas here. It is why I teach the classes here in the afternoon, in the evenings. It's why that I hope that you brothers and sisters are attending the Jumu'ah here. It is why there are some who volunteer and give their time here, because none of us are getting paid. But again, as I said, those values, they are priority to us. And that is what we are trying to represent and stand for here at Masjid Tawfiq North. And so I want to invite and encourage any of you brothers and any of you sisters that are here to come and be a part of that. Because as I mentioned before, brothers and sisters, none of us can do it alone. And I said we started back in September. And if you've noticed, I have never asked, for the most part, anybody to do anything here. You see these microphones, the setup with the camera, the cleaning of the masjid, the flyers that you see. And now you see there's a Facebook page, all of these different things. Just a couple of brothers, and we ask nobody for help. But just like I'm telling you now in the khutbah that people can't do it alone, I'm acknowledging that myself, and I'm asking all of you to come and help and be a part of this effort at this masjid in any way that you can, whether it's financially, whether it's your help, whether it's your expertise, whether it's wallahi just to pick up a few pieces of trash off of the floor. It doesn't matter, brothers and sisters. Everything is valued and important here when it comes to the commitment to these values. And in the name of those values, brothers and sisters, starting with knowledge, Inshallah, on February 10th, we will be starting a class, the tafsir, or the explanation of Juz Amma. And again, we invite all of you here, brothers, sisters, young, inshallah, we will have daycare, all of you are invited. And we ask that you share that with others and let others people and others know. And we ask that you come and be a part of this effort and what we're trying to do here, which is only ultimately boils down to one thing. It is the honor, the glorification, the veneration, and the raising of the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala above all else. Nothing else. And I ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala join our hearts upon the book of Allah, upon the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon an understanding of his companions and those who follow them in righteousness. I ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send his peace and blessings upon the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his family. And I ask that he send upon his pure family and his good companions and all those who follow them in righteousness until the last day. Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqa warzuqna ittiba'. Allahumma arina al-batila batila warzuqna ijtinaba. I ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala show us the truth for what it is and to give us the strength, the courage, and the sincerity to follow it. I ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala show us falsehood for what it is and to give us the strength, the courage, and the sincerity to stay away from it and to stand up against it. And I ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honor the Muslims and Islam, and that he denigrate those who are the enemies to Islam and those who would try to harm us. May he return that back on them. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala aid and alleviate the suffering and the difficulties of the Muslims all over the Muslim world. Those who are weak, those who are oppressed, those who have debts, may Allah alleviate them. Those who are sick, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cure them. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala join our hearts and those of us who are here, all of the masajid and all of the leaders of the Muslims here and the congregants in the Twin Cities, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unite their hearts upon that which is good and pleasing to him. Wa aqimu salah.